comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not. We pray for blessings, we pray for peace. comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? Pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not. Long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life, your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know the pain reminds this heart that this is not
holy name. Sing like never sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy.
What a great song. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Let us worship his holy name. I was listening to a podcast over the weekend, and they were talking about just the problems with postmodernism today and reinterpreting and deconstructing scripture and the rise of secular humanism and all these things. And they were talking about if there's like one doctrine, one thing that the church can focus on to address these things, what do you think it would be? And they arrived on talking about the doctrine of creation, just Genesis 1:1. How in the beginning the Lord created the heavens and the earth, and in all the implications that flow from that, that God is the one who created heaven. God is the one who owns the earth. God is the one who defines truth in our universe. God is the one who defines justice in our lives. And as God created the universe, he created the earth, he is also this sort of, eschatological view, that there is an end that God has in mind. God has a reason and a purpose for these things, and it is to bring glory and honor and praise to his name through the work of Jesus Christ. And just thinking about that thing that we all, you hear, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Yeah, I know that. But just for us to pause and to think through all of those implications that it has for us every day, that this time right now, this is God's, that this church is God's, that your life belongs to God, and how we can reorient all of our lives to line up with that truth, that we are here, we exist for this God. And what a great opportunity we have to worship together, to bless his holy name together, to hear from his word together. So welcome. We are glad you are here. Now welcome those who are watching on Facebook Live or on YouTube. We are glad you are tuning in as well. We miss you. We love you. Please let us know how we can be praying for you and encouraging you. I want to go through our announcements and our bulletin here. I got a new verse, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 and 14, as we work our way through 1 Peter. Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. So hide God's word in your heart. Psalm 119, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. We do it because we want to love God more with our lives. Remember, with COVID going on here, we encourage social distancing as you are comfortable. Some people have different levels of comfort, so we want to show grace to each one according to our convictions there. So please be mindful of others' comfort levels. Face masks are optional, but they are required for anyone singing. If you don't have a mask, we do have some in the very back there on the table. Also, kids' classes, remember there's the one quiet activity bag for kids. Please, parents, make sure you're cleaning the trash out of those. That way, Keisha doesn't have to, as she restocks those throughout the week, isn't like handling half-chewed crackers and things like that. So please make sure you grab your kiddos' trash out of the bags and leave the bags where you have them there, and Keisha will restock those. Coming up, I guess it's this coming Saturday, we have a baby shower for Miss Jordan K. Richardson, for Seth and Mandy's little girl. this Saturday, August 8th. Also, some more announcements there. Pray for our community, schools, and our leadership and our families there. Children of Grace Preschool that meets here on campus begins on the 13th. Shiloh and NSU will begin on the 17th of August, and then Tahlequah Public Schools will be starting now on August 27th. So please pray for our school systems. Please pray for our teachers. Pray for our kids for safety, that Christ will be magnified there as well. And also, I'll give my shameless plug because I'm the college pastor here. College classes are starting up soon. Historically, we have 5,000 to 6,000 college students who attend campus in person in Tahlequah every year. Obviously, with COVID, I don't know what that's going to look like. The school doesn't know what that's going to look like yet. But as you see new people, as you see young families, as you see young people, please welcome them to Tahlequah. Please welcome them to Grace. Please invite them to our church to join our church family. Introduce them. Introduce yourselves to them, and you know, don't be shy. So maybe you've met them before, maybe they're seniors, maybe they've been here for 4 years, but still, go meet people and get to know them and invite them here to be part of the body here. Ladies' dinner, we're going to have one, the ladies, I'm not going to be there. August 29th on Saturday, ladies' dinner and movie in the gym. This is for all ladies, high school age and older there, so check out the details there. Also, some more upcoming events there, the ladies' book study this fall. College students, we're having a welcome back lunch on Sunday, August 30th, right after church. And also, one thing not in your bulletin, we are having communion this coming Sunday, so a week from today. And so we always want to make sure that you are aware of that so that you are preparing your hearts to partake of the Lord's Supper, that you are taking it in a manner that is worthy, that you are reconciling with your brothers and sisters and not taking that in an unworthy way. One other thing, too, not on your bulletin there, just a friendly reminder. Please make sure you are grabbing your trash on the way out. We've been picking up lots of coffee cups and things like that after the service, and so please take care of that there. Also, pay attention to the prayer requests on the other side of the bulletin as well. We have a lot of hurting people in our body. I want to specifically point out Charlotte Kreider and her family. If you haven't heard, she was diagnosed with liver cancer, and she's on hospice. And so please be praying for Charlotte and for Dick and for Alan and for the Hispanic ministry as well. Please lift them up in prayer. And also, again, just a reminder, if you need prayer, if you need assistance of any kind, please let the pastors, the elders, the deacons know how we can be praying for you, how we can be supporting you and encouraging you there. And I think that is all I have there. And so with that, let's go to God in prayer. Thank you, Father, for your holy name. Thank you for revealing yourself to us. Thank you for the opportunity to come together with our brothers and sisters and to just be encouraged as we love on each other and get into each other's lives and we sing songs to one another and we sing to you and we hear from your word, Lord. Please help us to truly be a special moment for us. Lord, every day is your day, but this is our special day to gather together to worship you with our family. So, Father, please, would you be worshiped and honored truly and rightly from the bottom of our hearts, not just empty words, Lord, but help us to love you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength this morning. You would be magnified in the way that you deserve. And we ask in Jesus' beautiful name, amen.
Let's stand together. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am. Altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Commands all the hosts of heaven. Who else can make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What are the beauty demands such praises? What of the splendor outshines the sun? What of the majesty rose with justice? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. The glory consumes like fire. What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God.
Would offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him Father? Only a holy God, only my holy God. Come and behold him, the one.
Remain standing for the reading of God's word. Ryan's going to continue in 1 Samuel 26. I'm going to read Psalm 27 to go along with that. This is God's word. Psalm 27 of David. Yahweh is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yahweh is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. The war rise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I have asked of Yahweh that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of Yahweh all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of Yahweh and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to Yahweh. Hear, O Yahweh, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Yahweh, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. O you who have been my help, cast me not off. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but Yahweh will take me in. Teach me your way, Yahweh, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have arisen against me, and they breathe out violence. I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of Yahweh in the land of the living. Wait for Yahweh. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for Yahweh. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for your word. Lord, please do not let this be plain to us today. Do not let this be routine. Help us to see that your word is powerful. It is living and active. And Holy Spirit, would you speak through Ryan as he unfolds your word for us? Would you bring your word to our hearts to give us eyes to see and ears to hear, that we would fall more in love with you, that we would be convicted where we need to be and challenged and encouraged where we need to be, but above all, that you would be magnified in our lives as we walk out of these doors and we live for your kingdom this week. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
To acknowledge the king as her secular ruler, but as a Christian, she could never swear to his rule over her soul that belonged to Jesus Christ alone. She insisted that Jesus was the only sovereign king over his kingdom, and into his hands alone, she committed her eternal destiny. Well, for this crime, Margaret was tied to a stake in the Solway River, awaiting the inrushing tide. Farther out into the water, they had placed her friend, an older friend, Margaret Lackleson, so that the younger Margaret could witness her drowning and reconsider her obstinate refusal to swear allegiance to King James VII. Well, young Margaret was undeterred by what she saw, declaring that Christ himself was suffering in her friend. As the waters began to draw near her post and were rising, Margaret recited aloud the 8th chapter of Romans, concluding with Paul's great promise that not even death can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Well, the tide kept rolling in, and after she had suffered for a little while, her persecutors pulled her out and laid her on the beach and where she could gasp for air, and they asked her if she would pray for King James. She said that she would pray for his salvation. She assured them that she wished the salvation of all men. But they asked her if she would swear allegiance, the allegiance of spiritual allegiance, to Scotland's king. She said, "I will not." And upon hearing this, a soldier pushed her weakened body back into the water and held her underneath until she died. You know, we live in a time and place here in America where there seems to be very little bold allegiance to Jesus Christ in opposition to our culture. I think we need to remind ourselves that this world is not our home, and our citizenship lies elsewhere. Hebrews 13, 14 says this, "For here we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come." You can think of when Jesus was speaking to the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, and he said this, "My kingdom is not of this world." And the Apostle Paul reminds us in Philippians 3 that our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. We would do well to remember that this world did not love Jesus Christ, and it will not love his people. That hasn't changed. Remember the words of Jesus where he said in John 15, "If the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my word, they will also keep yours." So I would ask you, are you willing to stand alongside God's people, alongside the apostles of old, and the persecuted and martyred Christians through the ages, and say, "We will obey God rather than men"? Now, here I would say this too, is, you know, there's none of us that wants to be persecuted. I certainly don't want to. I would love to cut those things right out of my Bible, but I can't. None of us wants to be persecuted. None of us wants to be killed. But we need not fear the world for this. Listen to what Jesus said in Matthew 10. "And do not fear those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father." All right, get what he's saying there. Here's this little sparrow. It's worth a cent. Look at the care God has for that sparrow. Then he says this. He keeps going. "And not one of them fall, but even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, you are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven." You know, listen, church, our hope is not in the end of the coronavirus, nor is it in this coming election, no matter who wins or loses. Our hope, our strength, our eternal life is in the sovereign King of all creation. The King of every single king, the ruler over every ruler, the one who from him and through him and to him are all things, the one to whom glory belongs forever and ever. Amen. It is very true that we are to be, as our memory verse for this month falls, we are to be subject for the Lord's sake. You do this as unto the Lord, to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to the praise of those who do good. At the same time, just as the early disciples did, we must obey God rather than men. We need to seek our shelter in the Almighty. Psalm 118:8-9 says this, "It is better to take refuge in Yahweh than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in Yahweh than to trust in princes." You know, this is something I think we see played out in this next chapter of 1 Samuel. Here we have David, a man after God's own heart. He's being hated and hunted by the legitimate king, Saul. Saul has consistently shown himself to be in rebellion to the King of Kings and is himself under the judgment of God. David loves the Lord Yahweh And he is the man whom God has chosen to one day replace Saul, but the time is not yet. And as we study this book, we see the theme of 1 and 2 Samuel played out over and over again, which is this: in the midst of hopelessness, God will advance his plan of salvation for his glory and his people's good. Now, I want you to stop and think about that theme for a moment, because it is true today. Just as it was true then, it is still true today. Because we can look around us right now and think things seem pretty bleak and maybe even hopeless, but God is still in control today. His purposes are still marching forward. His plan of salvation continues. He will provide for and save his people. And listen, it's going to be clear that he's done it, and he alone will get the credit. We need to be a people that draw near to this God and live boldly for his purposes and rest in his providential care. I think that's what we see in the life of David. We see a man struggling, battling to do just that. Not an easy thing, but working out his salvation with fear and trembling. I've separated this chapter into four sections. I'll list them out here. The first is in verses 1 through 5 is the world stands opposed to Messiah and his people. The second section is verses 6 through 12, and it's God's providence should lead God's people to daring acts of obedience. The third is verses 13 to 16, and that's a lack of hypocrisy opens the door for truth. And then fourthly, in verses 17 to 25, the righteous person treasures God alone. So let's dive into this text and be encouraged to draw near to God, to live boldly for his purposes, and to rest in his providential care. All right, again, the first point here: the world stands opposed to Messiah and his people. Let's go ahead and read all of verses 1 through 5. That says this: then the Ziphites came to Saul at Gibeah, saying, is not David hiding himself on the hill of Hakilah, which is on the east of Jeshimon? So Saul arose and went down to the wilderness of Ziph with 3,000 chosen men of Israel to seek David in the wilderness of Ziph. And Saul encamped on the hill of Hakilah, which is beside the road on the east of Jeshimon. But David remained in the wilderness. When he saw that Saul came after him into the wilderness, David sent out spies and learned that Saul had indeed come. Then David rose and came to the place where Saul had encamped. And David saw the place where Saul lay with Abner, the son of Ner, the commander of his army. Saul was lying within the encampment while his army was encamped around him. All right, now this whole chapter might seem kind of like a familiar scene to something we've seen before. And it's something that happened in chapter 23. We read this in verse 19 of 23. It says, then the Ziphites went up to Saul at Gibeah, saying, is not David hiding among us in the strongholds of Horesh on the hill of Hakilah, which is south of Jeshimon? Very similar to what's happening right here. And in fact, liberal scholars would want us to believe that really this is two accounts of the same happening, same event. But there's no reason to believe that that's true. These are two events that are very similar, but yet they still have some differences in what happens and what takes place. Here again, we have the people of Ziph betraying the chosen one, David, betraying him and his followers into the hands of Saul. And not only are they willing to do this evil again, but Saul still hasn't learned his lesson. Remember what happened last time. David went up, and remember, he snuck up in the cave and he cut a corner off of his robe. Could have easily killed Saul at that time, but he didn't. And Saul recognized this. Listen to what he said in chapter 23. He said, actually, this is chapter 24, verse 17 to 18. It says, you are more righteous than I. Here's Saul speaking to David after this happened. You are more righteous than I, for you have repaid me good, whereas I have repaid you evil. And you have declared this day how you have dealt well with me, in that you did not kill me when Yahweh put me into your hands. So may Yahweh reward you with good for what you have done to me this day. So here's Saul realizing these things, and in spite of that, he is still striving to kill David. He gathers 3,000 chosen soldiers to hunt down David and his followers. When David learns of this, he gets up close enough so that he can see what's taking place, and there is Saul surrounded by his army. I think Saul right here is a good picture. He's kind of a bad picture of this truth, though. The truth is this, is that worldly powers stand opposed to Messiah and his people. Throughout history, there have been seasons of peace. I think we've been in one much of our lives. But listen, that's not the norm. Throughout church history, throughout the history of Messiah, Saul here could easily represent the corruption that afflicts all earthly powers apart from God's saving grace. Why is Saul back after David again? Well, it's simple. People in sin are ever ready to commit evil. And that seems all the more true of men and women who exercise great authority. Men and women who are in positions of power and authority. If you don't agree with me saying that, then I challenge you just to turn on your news feed or your Facebook and see what pops up. You'll have never-ending reports of leaders today with their sexual sins and their lies and their frauds and their cover-ups. In their pride, they think that they can get away with it. Their depraved natures lead them into self-destroying sins. You would think by now that Saul would have figured out that God was not going to let him kill David. But power and authority are just deadly to a person's soul. You know, how could Scotland's king, from the story I told you earlier, how could Scotland's king possibly think that drowning a teenage girl would somehow enhance his spiritual authority? Or how today could communist China still continue to not see that their persecution of the church is actually causing the church to flourish and grow? And many of you are aware of our brothers and sisters at Grace Community Church in California. They have taken a stand and said, we're going to meet and worship and serve God as he's called us to. Church, we have to realize something, or keep reminding ourselves, the culture around us and the political entities around us, they are not neutral. Listen to what Paul wrote, or John rather, toward the end of his letter, the first epistle of John, 1 John. He said this, and we know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. When you hear that, that sounds kind of bleak and desperate. But listen, we should be desperate. Desperate for God's presence. Right after John said that about the whole world being the power of the evil one, he finished the letter with these two verses, and he said this, and we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. You know, opposition from this world may grow. I think we are moving more and more into a time where we're going to experience that as Christians in our country. I wish that it weren't so. I wish that we could hand my children the America of the 1950s. Well, maybe I don't, because God is sovereign. He's moving it right where it needs to be, isn't he? But opposition may grow, but we have a mighty God, and we stand strong together in him. David gives us a good example as we continue in the story. Look at the next section here, verses 6 through 12. God's providence should lead God's people to daring acts of obedience. All right, so what's David going to do? Here he is staring down at 3,000 elite soldiers, the army of the powerful king of Israel who wants him dead. Well, look at verses 6 and 7. Then David said to Ahimelech the Hittite and to Joab's brother Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, who will go down with me into the camp of Saul? That's probably what you would have done, right? Hey, let's go down there. And Abishai said, I will go down with you. So David and Abishai went to the army by night. And there lay Saul sleeping within the encampment with his spear stuck in the ground at his head, and Abner and the army lay around him. So David asked two men in his camp, who will go with him down into this enemy camp? Now, we don't know who Ahimelech the Hittite is. He's not mentioned anywhere else in Scripture. But Abishai is David's nephew, the son of his sister Zeruiah, and he agrees to go. So they sneak down by night into the center of the camp where Saul is sleeping, and next to him is Abner, the commander of the army. And so there's Saul, sound asleep, with his spear stuck in the ground right by his head. Oh yeah, here's the opportunity. Here it is. God's put him right in his hands. That's what Abishai thinks. Look at verse 8. Then Abishai said to David, God has given your enemy into your hand this day. Now please let me pin him to the earth with one stroke of the spear, and I will not strike him twice. Again, this account is so similar to what happened before in chapter 23 and 24. Here's Saul, vulnerable, easy pickings. And the man with David, he's encouraging him, saying, listen, God, this is it. This is God's providence. He's put him right in your hands. Let me kill him. It'll be easy. One strike, I won't miss. But David will not disobey God and take the life of the current king of Israel, the rightful king at this time. Look at verses 9 through 11a. But David said to Abishai, do not destroy him, for who can put out his hand against Yahweh's anointed and be guiltless? And David said, as Yahweh lives, Yahweh will strike him down, or his day will come, or he will go down into battle and perish. Yahweh forbid that I should put out my hand against Yahweh's anointed. Listen, David will succeed Saul as king. And that's by God's decree. God would place David as king, and it wasn't David's place to make that happen. Were David to take the throne by his cunning or his strength, well, then David would get the glory, not God, right? And God forbid that David would take the throne by doing evil. David, I think, had learned his lesson in the last chapter that Kyle preached last week with Nabal. You might remember from that chapter how God had protected David from doing the evil that was in his heart and taking vengeance. He did this by sending Abigail to intercede and reason with David. Well, you remember what happened to Nabal after that? God took him out. Chapter 25, verse 38 says, Yahweh struck Nabal and he died. Not only that, but after that in verse 39, it says this. It says, when David heard that Nabal was dead, he said, blessed be Yahweh who has avenged the insult I received at the hand of Nabal and has kept back his servant from wrongdoing. Yahweh has returned the evil of Nabal on his own head. You know, as David's in this encounter, think about this. He doesn't know how God's going to handle this situation. I mean, he says that. He's like, here's the different things that could happen. But he's confident that God will do it. His hope is in the Lord. So how could he offend Yahweh by raising his hand against the king that God had put in place? Look at verses 11b through 12. But take now the spear that is at his head and the jar of water and let us go. So David took the spear and the jar of water from Saul's head and they went away. No man saw it or knew it, nor did any awake, for they were all asleep because a deep sleep from Yahweh had fallen upon them. David will not dishonor the Lord by killing his anointed king. But he's got a plan, and we'll see that in a moment. So to set up his plan, he takes Saul's spear, and he takes Saul's, I guess you could call it his personal canteen. This is his Nalgene bottle sitting there. This jar of water would have been the vessel that Saul's going to drink from. Of course, you know, the exalted king of Israel is not going to share a common cup with common soldiers, and so this was his personal water jar. But the spear, on the other hand, there's a little more significance there. This was Saul's ever-present spear, a symbol of his power. You might remember some things that Saul's done with this spear in the past. In 1 Samuel 18, we read this: the next day a harmful spirit rushed upon Saul, and he raved within his house while David was playing the lyre, as he did day by day. Saul had his spear in his hand, and Saul hurled the spear, for he thought, I will pin David to the wall. But David evaded him twice. This is the spear of office that he's tried to kill David with. And not just once, but we also get to chapter 19. We read this again. Then a harmful spirit from Yahweh came upon Saul as he sat in his house with his spear in his hand. And David was playing the lyre. And Saul sought to pin David to the wall with his spear, but he eluded Saul so that the spear struck into the wall, and David fled and escaped that night. This is that spear. It seems kind of whenever Saul is pictured, he's pictured there sitting with his spear. In fact, another time in chapter 22 talks about how Saul had learned where David was, and he's sitting at Gibeah under the tamarisk tree, and it says he sat there with his spear in his hand and all his servants around him. So I would imagine that for both Saul and David, this spear was pretty significant. Saul had sought to kill David multiple times with this spear, but David would not retaliate. He would not return evil for evil. And notice here in this chapter, in these verses here, the providence of God. How is it that David and Abishai could sneak into an enemy encampment without being detected, get in and get out, stealing things all along the way? Well, verse 12 tells us, no man saw it or knew it, nor did any awake, for they were all asleep because a deep sleep from Yahweh had fallen upon them. God brought success to David's hand. The Lord had protected David up to this point, and he would continue to do so. David didn't know what God was doing behind the scenes. I don't think he had an understanding here that God was going to put a deep sleep on them. But he was confident in the Almighty. And what did that lead him to do? It led him to bold acts of obedience and faith. The providence of God here didn't lead him to disobey God and strike Saul, but his confidence in God led him to obey God in the midst of overwhelming odds. Let me ask you, folks, is your God big enough to lead you to bold acts of faith and obedience? Is he big enough to lead you to share the gospel with your doctor, with your neighbor, with your coworker, with your boss? Listen, you may not know how God is going to fix your marriage, but you do know that you cannot fix it by committing adultery and dishonoring Him. You may not know how you're going to have the finances to pay your bills, but you do know that you can't dishonor God and somehow try to meet it through theft or lies. So again, let me ask you, how big is your God? If He's not big enough for your problems, then could I suggest that you have the wrong God? If He's not big enough to fulfill the promises of Scripture, then He's not the God of Scripture. Turn with me for a moment to Isaiah chapter 40. I was just going to read this, but I want you to look at it. Because we're going to ask the question, who is the God of Scripture? Isaiah is going to answer that. Isaiah chapter 40, we're going to read a fairly lengthy section. This is verses 12 through 31. Isaiah 40, starting in verse 12. So we're asking, who is this God of Scripture? Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, and marked off the heavens with a span, and closed the dust of the earth in a measure, and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance. Who has measured the Spirit of Yahweh? Or what man shows him his counsel? Whom did he consult? And who made him understand? Who taught him the path of justice and taught him knowledge and showed him the way of understanding? Behold, the nations are like a drop from a bucket and are accounted as the dust on the scales. Behold, he takes up the coastlands as fine dust. Lebanon would not suffice for fuel, nor are its beasts enough for a burnt offering. All the nations are as nothing before him and are accounted by him as less than nothing and emptiness. To whom then will you liken God? Or what likeness will you compare with him? An idol? A craftsman casts it, and a goldsmith overlays it with gold and casts for it silver chains. He is too impoverished for an offering. He chooses wood that will not rot. He seeks out a skillful craftsman to set up an idol that cannot move. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows on them and they wither and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me that I should be like them, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host by number, calling them by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from Yahweh, and my right is disregarded by God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? Yahweh is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for Yahweh shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. That's God. That is the only God. All others are pathetic idols, the doctrines, the teaching of demons. Church, listen, the called out, assembled people of God, that's you, the church, the knowledge of this breathtaking God should lead us to bold acts of obedience, trusting in his sovereignty and providence. David's a great example of stepping out and entrusting himself to the Almighty. The third section here is verses 13 to 16, and that's this: a lack of hypocrisy opens the door for truth. Start with verses 13 and 14. Then David went over to the other side and stood far off on the top of the hill, and with a great space between them. And David called to the army and to Abner, the son of Ner, saying, "Will you not answer, Abner?" And Abner answered, "Who are you who calls the king?" All right, so get the picture here. So David, he gets safely away with the spear and with the jar, and he goes to another hilltop, and he calls out to the army, and in particular to Abner, the commander. Verses 15 and 16. And David said to Abner, "Are you not a man? Who is like you in Israel? Why then have you not kept watched over your lord the king? For one of the people came in to destroy the king, your Lord. This thing that you have done is not good. As Yahweh lives, you deserve to die because you have not kept watch over your Lord, the king, the Lord, over your Lord, Yahweh's anointed. And now see where the king's spear is in the jar of water that was at his head. All right, so here's Abner, the man above all other men who would have been tasked with protecting the king of Israel. And yet he had failed in that duty. Not only had Abner failed, but the entire army had failed. One of the things we don't see in our English there is when he's saying, you deserve to die because you have not kept watch. Those are all plural yous. He's talking to all of them. They've all been accused now of dereliction of duty, which was an offense worthy of death. And David proves that this is the case, that they left their king vulnerable when he shows what he's taken from right beside Saul's head. And what's interesting here too, if you think about it, is this. This entire army had failed, but there was one faithful servant of Saul in this story who protected him. And that servant was David. Abishai was ready to take Saul's life, but the servant of Saul, David, stepped in and held him back. And all the time that these two men had known each other, Saul and David, David had never done anything but good for his king. Had David here killed Saul, he couldn't have spoken like he just did. He would have been a hypocrite if he had tried to point out the armies, but yeah, I got in there and killed him. But because David walked in righteousness, in obedience to Yahweh, his king, he could open his mouth and speak the truth. A truth that must have cut this army and Abner just to the core and revealed that they had done wrong. Listen, church, it's going to be hard for us to tell the lost world around us about the treasure that we've found if we're treasuring the same things that they treasure. Are you treasuring Christ? Do you cherish God's fame? Or are you treasuring your comfort, your safety, your possessions, your reputation? Psalm 27:4, Kyle read it just a moment ago, but verse 4 says this, one thing, here's David, one thing I've asked of Yahweh, and this is what I'm going to seek after, that I may dwell in the house of Yahweh all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of Yahweh and to inquire in his temple. David was not a hypocrite. And that lack of hypocrisy allowed him to open his mouth and speak the truth. And church, we need to stand in that same place. The fourth section here is verses 17 to 25, and this is this. The righteous person treasures God alone. Start with verse 17. Saul recognized David's voice and said, "Is this your voice, my son David?" And David said, "It is my voice, my Lord, O King." Saul must also have been convicted by David's words. He could have been killed by David, and yet David had spared him. Notice, too, the honor that David gives to this unrighteous leader. Throughout the next verses, he continues to call him Lord. He calls himself his servant. Let's look at verses 18 to 20. And he said, "Why does my Lord pursue after his servant? For what have I done, and what evil is on my hands? Now, therefore, let my Lord the king hear the words of his servant. If it's Yahweh who has stirred you up against me, may he accept an offering. But if it is men, may they be cursed before Yahweh, for they have driven me out this day that I should have no share in the inheritance of Yahweh, saying, 'Go serve other gods.' Now, therefore, let not my blood fall to the earth away from the presence of Yahweh, For the king of Israel has come out to seek a single flea like one who hunts a partridge in the mountains. When you look at David's life and when Saul's looking at him here, there's nothing that he could pin on David as him having done wrong. He has only served faithfully. So why does the king want him dead? Here David says, listen, if I've done something wrong and God's sending you after me, then let me offer a sacrifice and confess my sin to God and be forgiven. But he says, but listen, but if it's men who are stirring up you, Saul, then let those men be cursed by God. I'm sure there must have been advisors around Saul that didn't want to lose their positions of prominence when a new king would come into power. It's always easy to surround ourselves with people who encourage us to do the wrong thing. You'll find plenty of ladies at work who will encourage you to dump that loser husband because, girl, you deserve better than that. You'll find plenty of voices that would encourage you not to waste your life by giving up your job so that you could go to the ends of the earth with the gospel. You'll find plenty of voices who will show you how to cut corners in business so that you can get ahead. These men around Saul wanted to see David run out of the land, out of the inheritance of Israel. You know, if David leaves the land, he's really being cut off from God in many ways because he is now separated from the corporate worship of God's people, from the tabernacle, from the priests, and from the sacrifices. That's where David longed to be. Psalm 63, 1 and 2 says this, O God, you are my God, earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, my flesh faints for you as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. These men were seeking to run David out of the promised land, the place where the glory of God dwelt on earth. It's as if they're saying, go serve another god, David. Look at verse 21. Then Saul said, I have sinned. Return, my son David, for I will no more do you harm, because my life was precious in your eyes this day. Behold, I have acted foolishly and have made a great mistake. This is just like what happened last time when David spared him. Saul sees his wrongdoing and he admits it. I think he genuinely feels bad here. And that's just my conjecture. But you know what there's no evidence of? There's no evidence that there's a true repentance. There's no evidence anywhere that there's been a change of heart toward Yahweh, much like what happened last time. David doesn't trust him, and you will see that in the next few verses. Look at verse 22, in fact. And David answered and said, well, here's the spear, O king. Let one of the young men come over and take it. Notice he doesn't go, oh, we're good now? Let me just walk on over and bring you the spear. No, he sends someone over. Listen, David trusts the Lord, and he wisely doesn't trust Saul. Look at verse 23 to 25. The Lord rewards every man for his righteousness and his faithfulness. For Yahweh gave you into my hand today, and I would not put out my hand against Yahweh's anointed. Behold, as your life was precious this day in my sight, so may my life be precious in the sight of Yahweh, and may he deliver me out of all tribulation. Then Saul said to David, blessed be you, my son David. You will do many things and will succeed in them. So David went his way, and Saul returned to his place. If David would have done wrong in this account and killed Saul, then there is no way that he could legitimately expect God to reward him. Had he done so, David probably could have stepped into the kingship more quickly and probably with less pain and difficulty. But then it would not have been a kingship established in righteousness. But notice here too that David's concern isn't what everybody thinks of him. It's not what Saul thinks of him, but it's how he is viewed in God's eyes. Verse 24, he says, behold, as your life was precious in my sight, so may my life be precious in the sight of Yahweh, and may he deliver me out of all tribulation. David's treasure was God. His hope was God. He looked to God to be the one to rescue him out of all of his troubles. I'd ask you again, what I asked you a moment ago is, what do you treasure? What is your eye drawn to? This world is full of darkness, and there is only one true light. That's Jesus, the light of the world. Trust him. Treasure him. Listen, church, you cannot serve two masters. We try to fool ourselves into thinking we can. If we can, then I'm sorry, Jesus is a liar. He's not. He's true. He's righteous. No one can serve two masters, and this master is worth it. As Martin Luther composed his song, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," he wrote this, Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. You ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabbath, his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God has willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. Let's pray. God, forgive us for how we belittle you, for how quickly and how easily we can turn our eyes from your greatness and your glory and your purposes and what you're doing right now in this world and will do in the future. God, grant us eyes to see and ears to hear. Father, I pray for your church today that you would cut out the competing idols from our hearts. Draw us to yourself. Lord, thank you for the example of David. Would you cause us to walk in righteousness so that we can speak lovingly and boldly to this world and tell them of the treasure we've found? Thank you, Lord, that you are the mighty fortress. You're a bulwark never failing. The end is sure. Just like David, Lord, we don't know what you're going to do or when. We don't know when you're going to return, but we've already read the end of the book. You won. You win. You are the Almighty. Father, I pray for the people of Grace Baptist Church that we would step out boldly because of our great God. That we would treasure you and share that treasure with this world. You deserve to be glorified. You deserved to have our hearts captivated by you and for others to be brought into a knowledge of salvation in Jesus Christ, and so that you would be glorified by those tongues for all eternity. So thank you, Lord, for the mighty victory we have in Jesus, our Savior, our only hope. I pray in his victorious and hopefully soon coming name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together and sing that hymn, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God."
mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal is prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. I did our own day confront, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth his name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. And though this world with devils broke, should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath lived his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fail him. That word above all earthly power, no thanks to them abided. The Spirit and the gifts are ours, to him who with us sided. Let goods and kindreds go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. His kingdom is forever. His kingdom is forever.
That word above all earthly power. Think of any earthly power you want. This word, the gospel of Jesus Christ, is above every one of those. And no thanks to them is it here at all. In fact, they tried everything they could to get rid of it. And go to China today, and they're trying to squash it, and it's like multiplying. The goods and kindred go. This mortal life also. They can kill the body. His truth is going to abide, and so will you. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. You are sent.